Wonderful to be here tonight. Victoria inaugural lectures play an important role in allowing new professors to reflect on how they add value to the wider community and to the academic community in which we all live and share. I would like to thank Vic's engagement and events team, who are so skilled at making these lectures happen. And I would also like to thank my fellow academics who are here tonight in the audience. But I would like to especially thank all the students who are here. And I have to say, I haven't seen this many students in one of my lectures in a long time. And particularly the students I want to thank are those who are recent alumni and now are coming as new members of the Wellington and Victoria and New Zealand community. These talks are meant to be about a new professor's research, which is fundamental to opening up new ways of thinking. I will indeed reflect upon my research toward the end of this talk, but to begin, the stories I plan to tell will reflect particularly on the importance of research-led teaching. I believe that through research-led teaching, the most important role of any academic is to teach our young students how to learn, indeed how to become lifelong learners. And to do this, I'm hugely privileged to serve as teacher, mentor, role model, and indeed a student myself, learning from my students as they learn from me in return. My most important role as a professor is to show my students that they can make a difference, and through their chosen discipline, whatever that may be, they have a voice that can be heard. I pledge to help my students learn to celebrate the great gift of learning from one another across all disciplines, across all ages, and across all cultures, giving back to their community as true whānau who practice and indeed celebrate whanaungatanga. When I first left architectural practice to begin my career as an academic, I assured my students that architecture can have a voice. And I alerted my students that as young New Zealanders born on the cusp of a new millennium, you also can indeed must have a voice. But like architecture, you can only develop a voice when you build upon ideas. For this reason, I would like to begin with a passage from a poem by T.S. Eliot, which provided the inspiration for the title of this lecture. For most of us, there is only the unattended moment, the moment in and out of time, the distraction fit lost in a shaft of sunlight, the wild time unseen, or the winter lightning, or the waterfall, or music heard so deeply that it is not heard at all, but you are the music while the music lasts. These are only hints and guesses, hints followed by guesses, and the rest is prayer, observance, discipline, thought, and action. In 2015, the New Zealand National Government's new tertiary education strategy advocated for closer links with industry, the sciences, and engineering, a link between the tertiary education strategy and its business growth agenda. And this government emphasis was tragically being made at the expense of the humanities and the social sciences. Our new Vice Chancellor, Grant Guilford, published an important rebuttal in the Dominion Post, writing, "The humanities and social sciences are not just about the joy of living. The arts, languages, and literature, and other humanities subjects play a central role in the celebration and critical reinterpretation of our national identity and our place in the world. The humanities are also central to the cultivation of creative capital. Creative capital is the curiosity and insight that finds new solutions to complex issues." Professional subjects like architecture play an important role in the government's aspirations for greater links with industry and its business growth agenda, but architecture cannot be studied in isolation without drawing deeply upon the humanities and the social sciences. For professional disciplines like architecture to have a voice, they must be built upon the foundation of a knowledge of subjects such as philosophy and religion, history and political science, languages and linguistics, classical studies, environmental studies, literature, film, music, and painting. And when built upon this structural foundation, architecture can have a voice. Award-winning architect Labius Woods wrote, Is architecture only an end product that people can physically inhabit? Or is it also the matrix of ideas, concepts, and designs that serve as inspirations for constructions that can be inhabited? The views about it that prevail will greatly influence not only the direction of architectural education, but also the priorities architects, clients, and public policymakers set for the field in the future. Labius Woods is referring to the voice of architecture, architecture's ability to provoke as well as to provide. Architecture can tell stories about issues that truly matter. Human laments, philosophical quandaries, spiritual quests, cultural empowerment, politics, and persecutions. The first time that I explored storytelling as an architecture student, I realized that I would never understand it or even recognize it if I looked only at buildings. So I began by looking at the humanities and social sciences and the tales they have to tell. Tonight, I will tell you 10 stories. Each tale is revealed first from the voice of humanities and social sciences, and then from the voice of architecture. I will begin with two stories about paintings. The first painting tells a story about place, and the second, a tale about time. The first painting that was a true narrative awakening for me was The Gleaners by Jean-François Millet, which was painted in 1857. Two classmates and I discussed the painting when we were young students in architecture school. The superficial story of three women working in the fields is obvious, but there is another deeper story conveyed through symbolism and composition. The two women on the left bent over in their back-breaking work take on similar shapes to the two large haystacks in the distance. The bent-over women are composed by Millet explicitly to be read as analogous to the inert stacks of hay. The woman on the right wears a hat, the same shape as the smaller haystacks. Her hat is the only element of the three women that intersects with the horizon, and it symbolically reads as one more of the many haystacks aligning the distance. These three women fundamentally belong to the landscape in which they toil. Their faces are turned away from us, and we realize that, like the haystacks, the impoverished women have become anonymous, without identity, mere pieces of the landscape. Now we understand the women's story, the underlying narrative of their lives. How might architecture tell a similar story? In 2004, New Zealand architect Chris Kelly of Architecture Workshop designed the multi-award-winning Peregrine Winery outside of Queenstown. Like the women in Millet's painting The Gleaners, this building fundamentally belongs to the landscape. The gradients of its hovering roof echo the gentle slopes of the Southern Alps in the background. The New Zealand Institute of Architects 2005 Supreme Award citation reads, "The central Otago landscape can overwhelm efforts to build into it in a meaningful way. Peregrine Winery achieves a fine balance between the natural and the fabricated by building both above and in this landscape. The visible gesture of an organizing roof is light and enigmatic, neither interior nor exterior, big or small. The program, in contrast, is built onto the land, carefully aligned to contour and ground condition and tuned to its purpose." The building tells a second story as well about its fundamental connection to the landscape. According to Architecture Workshop, the changing roof gradient was inspired by old still images freezing the kinetic rotation of a bird in flight. The roof is evocative of the majesty that the peregrine or native hawk has as it glides on the thermal uplifts off the heated land. Now we understand the building's story, the underlying narrative of its intimate connection to the place it inhabits. The next story draws simultaneously from literature, religion, and art history, as well as from painting. Author Donna Tartt wrote a Pulitzer Prize-winning novel called The Goldfinch, centered around this tiny 17th century Dutch painting by Carl Fabricius. The simple representation of a small bird on its perch is obvious, but the underlying story is far more poignant. By knowing our history, we recognize that the goldfinch was often used in Christian religious paintings to represent endurance and salvation. But this is a fettered goldfinch, trapped with no hope of escape. This is a story the artist is writing as much to depict himself as the tiny bird. Donna Tartt describes the bird like this. There is only a tiny heartbeat and solitude, bright, sunny wall, and a sense of no escape. Time that doesn't move, time that couldn't be called time. And trapped in the heart of light, the little prisoner unflinching. When an artist creates a painting such as this one that exposes their own heart and soul, the painting touches us personally. This is because we can universally relate to the little bird, so beautiful and proud, yet so vulnerable and trapped. Trapped not just by the literal chain on its leg, but also metaphorically trapped by the edges of the canvas that represent the limitations of its entire world. Viewers of the goldfinch not only see the story of a tiny bird, they recognize a shared, deep-seated narrative about their own lives as well. The painter Carl Fabricius, who tells us this poignant story about solitude and no sense of escape, time that couldn't be called time, in fact, died the same year he completed this autobiographical painting at just 32 years of age. So the question arises whether architecture can express a similar story as poignant as the tale of the tiny goldfinch. In 1936, Italian architect Giuseppe Turani designed the tomb for Roberto Sefarti, a young Italian man who was martyred during the fascist period. Like the goldfinch, the narrative of this work of architecture can be interpreted as time that doesn't move, time that couldn't be called time. Turani designed the stairway with risers that are greater than the treads, creating a feeling of struggle as one climbs upward. Half the stairs extend beyond the sidewalls, such that a visitor first ascends in sunlight before then ascending in darkness, with the thick sidewalls appearing to press forebodingly inward. At the top of the stairway, there is no landing, thus forcing the visitor to descend rather than remain in a place where they do not belong. Turani's design for a crypt contains a single rough stone column embedded permanently in the wall, symbolic of a doomed young man no longer free to venture forth, but instead forever trapped within the world below. Time that doesn't move, time that couldn't be called time. The next story draws simultaneously from classical studies, mythology, painting, and architectural history. Architects Leon Creer and Massimo Scolari exhibited a painting in 1975 at the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art called Le Désespoir de Janus, which translates as The Despair of Janus. This evocative title provides us with an important clue that a narrative tale is to be told. By knowing the classics, we recognize that Janus was the ancient Roman god with two faces, one facing the future and one facing the past. The despair of Janus, therefore, is that he never sees the present. Janus was worshipped as the god of architects because facing both out and in, he represents a threshold, a gateway, and a new beginning. This painting tells its story through the use of anthropomorphism, where we are invited to attribute human characteristics to the buildings. Like people, these two buildings stand erect, arms out, facing one another. We see the front of the orange building, but we only see the back of the blue one. We soon realize, however, that like Janus, they in fact represent two sides of just one building. The blue building has a glass element like a spinal cord that rises up its back and disappears over its head. This same blue glass element appears above the face of the orange building. The termination of the glass element that is concealed from view in the blue building becomes exposed in the orange one. Only by looking at both buildings together can we begin to understand their relationship as a whole. Behind the blue building is a third, much smaller edifice. Anthropomorphically, it represents a childlike form. Its spinal cord is still horizontal, not yet risen vertically. Its single archway, its threshold, is not yet the dual arches of its parents. Its own wing-like arms are in transition, somewhere between the solid arms of one parent and the light arms of the other. The two larger buildings represent the future and the past. They reach their arms out to one another, but their fingertips are destined to never touch. The small building represents the present. Formed yet unformed, it is unseen by either parent. By understanding these three buildings as one, we witness the despair of Janice. While readable on the surface as an anthropomorphic narrative about three buildings, we can discover an even greater hidden narrative in this painting when we know architectural history and the period when it was painted. Krier and Scolari have in fact depicted this architectural narrative as a poignant metaphor representing the postmodern dilemma of the 1970s. In 1959, Italian architect Carlo Scarpa was commissioned to redesign the ground floor of a 16th century palace in Venice, transforming it into the library for a cultural and historical foundation. Scarpa raised the new contemporary floor half a meter above the historic one, and he disengaged it from the historic walls. The old and the new never touch one another. And most significantly for the story Scarpa wanted to tell, he left one entire room unoccupied. But if you look closely, there is, in fact, an occupant. An historic column permanently embedded in the wall is indeed the living architectural inhabitant of the room beyond. Scarpa's new floor enters the room, but only a meter or so. The height of the elevated floor makes it impossible to advance into the past. Visitors from the present must return the way they entered. Like Janice, the past is in one direction and the future is in the other. This room, inhabited by the historic column, has one additional story to tell. Scarpa purposely did not raise the floor in this room, and every once in a while, during the high tides of Venice, the room floods. The historic space becomes one with the canals of Venice, and the column, the Heritage Palace's original sentinel, gazes upon its own reflection. The next story draws simultaneously from politics, religion, music, languages, and linguistics. For almost 50 years, from 1944 to 1991, the country of Estonia was occupied by the Soviet Union, which actively discouraged religion and promoted atheism. For this reason, Estonian composers had to be extremely careful when writing religious music to conceal it from the authorities. In 1976, Estonian composer Arvo Pärt wrote the religious instrumental work In Spe, which in Latin translates to hope. He explicitly selected a title that would conceal the religious connotations of the work from the authorities, but the composition was in fact based on the Kyrie of the Christian Orthodox Mass. Pärt analyzed the Latin words from the religious text, and he reinterpreted the structures of the text into musical rules for the melody, rhythm, and dynamics of the composition. Each syllable of each Latin word was assigned a specific pitch of music. The number of syllables per word determined the number of beats per measure of the rhythm. And in this way, the sacred text remained in full view, yet unseen. Later, in 1984, Pärt rearranged In Spe for voices and organ. And this time his title was a line taken from the Bible's Psalm 137, but in German. Voices were added to sing Kyrie eleison, Christi eleison, Kyrie eleison from the Christian Orthodox Mass. But to conceal the sacred Latin text, Pärt removed all the consonants, and the voices only sang the vowels. Once again, the sacred text remains in full view, yet unseen. A student might ask, how could an extraordinary story of innovation like this, that combines politics, religion, languages, and music, become inspiration for innovation in architecture? In 1982, architect Raymond Abraham entered a speculative architecture competition to design a Christian church next to the Berlin Wall, at a time when religion was not allowed in East Berlin. And like Arvo Pärt, his concept was to conceal religion in plain sight. Raymond Abraham's original architectural concept sketches included a series of horizontal, vertical, and diagonal elements that would define a gathering space, but not be recognizable as a traditional church. His original concept was to arrange the architectural elements such that when the sun rises in the morning, these elements would cast a shadow of a crucifix upon the Berlin Wall, which would move continually across the wall from morning until dusk. The next story draws from early 1960s radical filmmaking. When I was in my third year of architecture school, one of the first things my design supervisor did was to show us an old movie by French architect Jean-Luc Godard, who was considered to be the most radical filmmaker of the 1960s and 70s. Godard challenged the conventions of traditional filmmaking by drawing explicitly upon alternative disciplines such as history, philosophy, literature, classics, fine arts, politics, and architecture. My supervisor, John Haydick, challenged us to learn new ways of thinking about architecture by investigating radical filmmakers. The 1963 Godard film that he showed us was called Le Mépris, which translates as contempt. It is a film about the making of the film, about an epic poem from ancient Greek history, the Odyssey. So the film is a story within a story within a story. Most importantly, the film is told through the voice of a building that has a story to tell, the Casa Malaparte, designed in 1937 by architect Alberto Libera. This house is sited on the island of Capri in Italy. This is how John Haydick described to us, his students, the story of this house. Libera's Malaparte house is private. It is a house of paradoxes. It is an object which consumes. It is filled with unrequited histories. It is a relic left upon the pinnacle after the seas have subsided. It is a sarcophagus of soft cries. It whispers of inevitable fates. Imagine designing a house that would be described like that long after you are gone. Imagine describing yourself as having unrequited histories, whispering of inevitable fates. The next story draws from philosophy. Michel Foucault was a French philosopher who presented us with what he referred to as a critical history of modernity. I will read to you a passage from one of his seminal works, Of Other Spaces, which was first presented at a conference for architectural studies in 1967. There are, in every civilization, real places, places that do exist and that are formed in the very founding of society, which are something like countersites, a kind of effectively enacted utopia in which the real sites, all the other real sites that can be found within the culture, are simultaneously represented, contested, and inverted. Places of this kind are outside of all places, even though it may be possible to indicate their location in reality. Because these places are absolutely different from all the sites that they reflect and speak about, I shall call them, by way of contrast to utopias, heterotopias. I believe that between utopias and these quite other sites, these heterotopias, there might be a sort of mixed joint expression, which would be the mirror. The mirror is, after all, a utopia, since it is a placeless place. In the mirror, I see myself there where I am not, in an unreal virtual space that opens up behind the surface. I am over there, there where I am not, a sort of shadow that gives my own visibility to myself, that enables me to see myself there where I am absent. Such is the utopia of the mirror. But it is also a heterotopia insofar as the mirror does exist in reality, where it exerts a sort of counteraction on the position that I occupy. From the standpoint of the mirror, I discover my absence from the place where I am, since I see myself over there. Starting from this gaze that is, as it were, directed toward me, from the ground of this virtual space that is on the other side of the glass, I come back toward myself. I begin again to direct my eyes toward myself and to reconstitute myself there where I am. The mirror functions as a heterotopia in this respect. It makes this place that I occupy at the moment, when I look at myself in the glass, at once absolutely real, connected with all the space that surrounds it, and absolutely unreal, since in order to be perceived, it has to pass through the virtual point, which is over there. How might architecture tell a similar story to a philosopher about a place that is at once absolutely real and absolutely unreal? Japanese architect Hiroshi Nakamura told such a story in his design for Optical Glasshouse, which was built in the city of Hiroshima in 2012. The three inhabitants of this house are the wind, the sunlight, and the rain. Thank you. The next story draws from Maori studies and cultural studies. One of the most beautiful tales of Aotearoa is told by women in the form of the karanga. It is a spiritual call that has been heard in Aotearoa for generations, and it provides the medium by which the living and the dead of the manuhiri, or visitors, may cross the physical space to unite with the living and the dead of the Tanata Whenua, the people of the land. How might architecture draw inspiration from such a tale? My own first experience of a karanga when I first arrived in New Zealand was on the edge of a forest in Rotorua. The sound of a woman's voice emanated from the dark woods, the woman unseen. Later, I used this moving experience to inspire my design for the New Zealand Tomb of the Unknown Warrior, which was to be located on the steps of the War Memorial in Wellington. The idea was to create a New Zealand tomb and memorial that represent the primordial forest of Aotearoa, from whose shadows the karanga will be eternally heard. In collaboration with my student and future academic colleague Erica Kruger, we designed this forest to become a home for the unknown warrior as a symbol of all New Zealand. The memorial is designed as a grove of solemn bronze posts set within a shallow reflecting pool. The dark bronze posts and water symbolize the primal New Zealand forest that once defined our sacred shore. The shadows of these dark posts move slowly along the paving surrounding the memorial, marking time like a permanent sundial. The lower level of the memorial contains the tomb wherein the unknown warrior lies. This lower level steps gradually upward and sits within a pool of water like our island home. The black posts extend down through memorial, surrounding the warrior and protecting them within the glade of trees. The glass tombstone is engraved with the words "A New Zealand Warrior" in both English and Te Reo Māori. Light enters the memorial through a similar tempered glass paver set within the reflecting pool above, reminiscent of light filtering through the tops of trees. The glass paver above is engraved with the same words as the one below, such that the silhouette of these words falls as soft shadows upon the walls and floor of the tomb. Nestled within the symbolic trees is a clearing, a glade which holds a gilded sphere floating upon the water. We occasionally hear the sound of soft chiming as the sphere strikes the posts. The tomb represents a grove of sacred shadows providing haven for the light and the soft sounds of music, the karanga, emanating forever from within. The golden sphere represents the spirit of the unknown warrior. Simultaneously, it becomes our own New Zealand version of the eternal flame. As the sun moves across the sky, we see bright reflections from the sphere flickering through the shadows of the primal forest. The reflections fade away at twilight, only to return again with the dawn. The next story, which draws from Pacific studies and fine arts, illustrates how these ideas have been brought to life through my teaching. One of the most beautiful tales of the Pacific Islands is told by women in the form of tapa cloth. The rhythmic sound of women beating the mulberry bark is a ritual shared by every Pacific Island nation. Each Pacific Island culture calls its bark cloth by a different name, but they all know it also as tapa, and its patterns and uses echo the heritage and rituals of daily life. How might architecture draw inspiration from such a tale? New Zealand artist John Pule saw these fabrics as incarnations of an architecture. By this he meant an organization of space, a constitution of the environment, a working of nature that made it habitable and gave it an aesthetic. He also thought they were like portraits and stories, expressions of particular lives. In Niue, tapa is called hiapo. John Pule drew inspiration from hiapo, translating it into his own unique form of contemporary art. His paintings incorporate mythical monsters taken from island stories as well as from his own childhood dreams. navigation compasses that represent the instruments of contemporary global commerce and narratives of migration, stick figures that echo his earliest childhood drawings, the Christian cross to depict the impact of missionaries. Poulet says, "I did my first paintings trying to almost copy Hiapo. I was working in grids because that's what I saw. Hiapo was basically made up of grids, and then these pictures and storytelling. I was able to express myself and use all these things that I'd been thinking about and dreaming about, building them up, putting them into this Hiapo architecture and a Polynesian way of looking at things." When I teach, I invite each of my students to draw inspiration from their own unique culture and personal identity. One of my young Pacifica students lamented to me that she had spent most of her life in New Zealand and knew little of her ancestry. Her grandparents still lived on the tiny remote island of her homeland, but Kafoa had not been there since she was a small child, and she remembered little of the language. I asked Kafoa if she might telephone her grandmother each week, asking her to recall the rituals of her island nation. Her maternal grandmother happily agreed, but she stipulated that she would only tell Kafoa the stories in their native language, which she would speak slowly, and it was Kafoa's role to safeguard these stories for her own daughter someday and for her daughter's daughter. John Poulet has described tapa as incarnations of an architecture made up of grids that invite storytelling. So Kafoa began to create her own architectural tapa with her own grid, each square room representing one of the sequential tales told by her maternal grandmother. The tales describe the ritual stages in transforming from a young girl into a young woman during the wedding ceremony. Each of these stages Kafoa translated into an architectural room using a single column to represent the young girl transforming during each of the sequential rituals. The first room of Kafoa's architectural tapa is about innocence, and the final room is about wisdom. And when the architectural model is folded at its pivot point, both the innocence of the young girl and the wisdom of the woman come together and become one. Kafoa called her architectural tapa, "I Remember." And Kafoa now is the mother of her own little girl. The next story, which draws from environmental studies, classical studies, art history, language, and poetry, illustrates how these ideas have been brought to life through my research. In 2010, we were honored by being selected to exhibit a retrospective of 5 years of our design research in the Italy Pavilion at the Venice Architecture Biennale, which is one of the most prestigious events in the world for showcasing cutting-edge architectural design research. The Biennale's Italy Pavilion selected architectural research specifically responding to its theme, work that unveils a vision of architecture as civil art, capable of generating solutions for a society in the midst of deep-seated change. The work began in 2005 when I was invited by American installation artist Kristen Jones to collaborate with her on a grand vision that would fundamentally blur the boundaries between art and architecture. The project was called Tevere Eterno, which translates as the Eternal Tiber River. The research site was a half-kilometer stretch of the Tiber River in the center of historic Rome that was the identical size of the ancient Circus Maximus. The Circus Maximus, now only a trace upon the landscape, had once been the most important center for public gathering in the ancient Roman Empire, but no such site fulfills this vital function today. In seeking to return such a site to Rome once again, the research began by investigating how the Tevere Eterno site had evolved over time. The site transformed many times over the course of history, ultimately becoming the only straight segment of the Tiber River. The site also evolved over time from an open site to one that was completely overgrown and visited only by drug addicts and criminals. The principal research question asked how such a site in the heart of Rome could, by blurring the boundaries between art and architecture, be rejuvenated into an important civic center for the capital city, while also renewing place identity for its people. According to legend, Rome had been founded by Romulus and Remus, who were suckled as infants by a she-wolf. The concept for Tevere Eterno was to reawaken the she-wolf on the Tevere Eterno site as a rejuvenated symbol of Rome's identity. 12 historic images of the Roman she-wolf were collected and traced from ancient illustrations, carvings, amulets, and coins. 12 8-meter-high she-wolf stencils were then created and attached to the Tiber River walls in chronological order, showing how her image had transformed over time. Centuries of patina was washed away to reveal the she-wolves that had always lived upon the ancient walls. Tevere Eterno, the Eternal Tiber River Project, was formally initiated in 2005 when the Rome Ministry of Culture approved this first major work, the creation of 12 she-wolf images along the embankment walls of the Tiber River that would mark it as a permanent site for future contemporary urban scale interventions. This was followed in 2006 by 4 arias at the Edge of Darkness, and in 2007 by Luminalia, which reawakened the serpent of fire of the ancient Roman god of medicine, whose temple faces onto the Tevere Eterno site. The project then expanded beyond Rome. In 2008, she-wolves from Tiber to Hudson was invited to be shown on the walls of Castle Clinton, overlooking the Statue of Liberty. In 2009, Intermezzo was commissioned for the Birth of Rome celebrations and projected onto the facade of Michelangelo's Capitoline Museum. And in 2010, Fluviale was created for Venice, projecting the waters of Venice upon the facades of her architecture using flowing lines of poetic text about the importance of ensuring the sustainability of our waterways. The final story, which draws from literature and medieval history, illustrates how these ideas have been brought to life through my research in New Zealand. A few years ago, the Museum of Wellington commissioned me to create a new work for the New Zealand International Arts Festival to be located in their main exhibition space on a 3-story high atrium wall. I call this new work Vessels. Vessels was inspired by a passage in Book 2 of Dante Alighieri's epic poem Commedia, otherwise known as the Divine Comedy. This passage, written by Dante in the early 14th century, predicted that directly opposite Jerusalem, in the great oceans of the southern hemisphere, lies an island above which shines a constellation of stars in the shape of a cross. If you research the latitude and longitude of Jerusalem, you discover that the island directly opposite Jerusalem is in fact New Zealand. The reason that this discovery was particularly inspiring for me was that Dante's epic poem declares that atop this island still sits the original Garden of Paradise. And so this became the inspiring narrative tale that I wanted to offer to New Zealanders. The title Vessels was inspired by a line in the Divine Comedy, where Dante is told that each time an angelic vessel arrives to take new souls to the island of paradise, the vessel reflects light so radiant that the eye can barely endure it. Vessels initially required research in the humanities, interpreting passages from a great piece of literature. But later, Vessels required a very different type of research, the setting up of an off-site testing lab, soon followed by on-site, full-scale experimentation. Like the form of the sacred island described in the Divine Comedy, Vessels was structured as 7 terraces suspended upon the museum's atrium wall. Upon the terraces, I placed 33 glass vessels of water, representing the 33 cantos, or songs, of Book 2 of the poem. The 33 glass vessels were conceived and designed to vibrate in response to the movement of visitors in the museum. When no visitors are present, the work remains still. But when visitors gather, the vibrations send a myriad of light reflections from the glass bowls, in this way representing the sacred vessel in the Divine Comedy that reflects light so radiant that the eye can barely endure it. On opening night, when the museum was filled with visitors, the reflections began. The reflected light in vessels represents a threshold between land and water, light and darkness, time and eternity. but primarily it was conceived to reawaken our recognition of New Zealand as the earthly garden of paradise. I would like to conclude my talk by speaking briefly on the importance of maintaining innocence, even while opening our students' eyes to greater levels of awareness. As a teacher, I can only accomplish this challenge by embracing rather than erasing the innocence of my students. Their innocence is their greatest gift, for it provides them with the essential ability to dream. Fare forward, you who think you are voyaging. You are not those who saw the harbor receding or those who will disembark. Here, between the hither and the farther shore, while time is withdrawn, consider the future and the past with an equal mind. The voice of architecture is your voice. And for those of you wondering whatever happened to the little trapped goldfinch, the artist Carl Fabricius included another story in his painting as well, a secret tale of hope just for himself. Fabricius stretched his canvas onto a wooden panel, and in the back of the panel, he included a trap door, an escape hatch. Thank you.